Okay, Lonzo? Can I say okay?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, please.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all. Thank you, the committee, for giving the opportunity to be able to give some preliminary findings on some study we are doing. Name is Fidelis Kilonzo. I'm a bioassistant, or what you call agricultural engineer, in Kenyatta University, Kenya. And this presentation is part of a study called Eco-Friendly Urban and Variable Agriculture, funded by the University of Las Grant, Kenyatta University. The city I'm talking about is Nairobi. Once upon a time, Nairobi was described as the city in the sun. Of course, it's still in the sun, it hasn't moved yet. A few things happen in Nairobi. One, you get lots of sun, and for those who are sports fans, a few weeks ago, we hosted the World Junior Athletic Championship. Actually, my university campus was where 2,000 athletes were staying for 2 weeks. When you talk about feeding the city in Nairobi, population comes in three categories. We have the elves, who will not be feeding today. We have the pretenders, who are somewhere between the elves and the half-nots, and we have the half-nots, who are actually the kind of people we are going to be feeding in this presentation. I am calling them half-nots because we have a population of 4 million people in Nairobi, and about half of that live in a slum situation, or nearly kind of situation. We have a few challenges in Nairobi, and the first challenge is water. We have, in the last 2 years, a serious water shortage, and of course, when there's water shortage, then of course that spills over to all other spheres of health and sanitation. We have a problem with waste. Unfortunately, this one problem that has refused to go away in our city. We have, this is not a problem, it's actually a very good thing. A lot of open market kind of shopping, where last year you are doing a lot of supermarket shopping, we do a lot of open market. Fresh produce from the farm to the market, to the user, the same day. And of course, the situation is like that. We have, as I said, a population of around 4 million. And of course, that coupled with the waste, water, open air market, we have a problem with the diseases. And just a few weeks ago, we had, unfortunately, just after the games ended, an outbreak of cholera. We don't know whether it was the people who came in who brought us the cholera or it was there, but we had cholera. And that was not quite, very interesting, especially when you're dealing with the open markets and water problem. Why urban agriculture? Urban agriculture is a very small component in a large community-based food system. Cities like Nairobi and I imagine they get a lot of food from outside the cities, but still within the cities and especially within the populations who live outside the city. Because a city like Nairobi had its initial boundaries. Then, because of rural urban migration, a lot of people who came to the city and they settled in what we call the peri-urban areas. Areas that were not serviced with water, areas that were not serviced with the sewer network, and areas that were not in the grid. We call them off-grid areas. So these people have to make do in whatever they have, so they kind of start now doing this farming. The other thing is, this urban farming mostly takes place in areas that are not owned by these people who are doing the farming. It's reserves, for instance, waves and flooded areas, river banks, and this kind of setups where they actually have no ownership. It's very important for the resilience of the communities, contributes to connections, contributes to food security, and empowerment, especially of women. And the household is a source of income. These families who are in the occupation may have no other source of livelihood. They also provide very nutritious food crops, especially vegetables and fruits. And of course, because of the small women, the rabbits and also the chicken improves the diet. Mothers now, because they are within the environment where they are cultivating, then of course they don't spend a lot of time going to the market. This portion of the study aims to identify hotspots within the city metropolitan where we have this intensive agriculture farming, assess the quality that's been used for irrigating of these crops. Of course, most of the crops are grown when the rains have stopped. They're actually not rain-fed, but irrigated, or at least part of it is irrigated. And of course, we are trying so that we get any key environmental signatures. The approach used was identification of the sites. We did some sampling, both for water quality and for benthic macroinvertebrates. Did analysis, then the map, analysis and mapping, and maps and some statistics. Again, this Nairobi metropolitan in the center consists of mainly three federal counties, Nairobi, Kiambu, and Machakos, and these are the areas within the city, and we have the main arterials for the road network and the rivers. The hotspots were identified. We had like 9 hotspot areas where we have intensive agriculture using irrigation. So you can see this, the city center, and the main arteries for the roads are here, and the hotspots are distributed all over here. This is not a large scale production site. This is the city's wastewater treatment plant. They use the waste calculation ponds. So from the aerial map, they look like a large irrigation farm. So what crops are grown in this urban agriculture? We have crops that normally will be eaten raw. Lettuce and sugarcane, especially sugarcane. If you walked home from work in the evening in Nairobi, almost every other stop you find someone who is shaping sugarcane and selling to people. Even when the buses are moving, people are selling this sugarcane to people all over, especially in the evening, because this falls part of the evening snack for the people. There are those crops which are lightly cooked. Especially the kales, the spinach, and the tomatoes, and the African leafy vegetables. Cowpeas, others we have no names, like lettuce or pig weeds, manago, and such. And then, of course, very important for breakfast are the arrowroots, which are very common again in Nairobi. That's a typical farm. You see that the plots are quite small. You look at this, it's a small plot. This, and these are owned by different people. And you can see the crops that we are growing. What are the water sources? These are the different sources that we use for water. Of course, this is all river water. Don't mind the look at this point in time. But from fairly nice waters to levels of degradation of the water. But you can see this site, this is Kales right here, and of course the customers are right next to it. What are the methods of irrigation that are used? So that's the water source. Then you have, most of the time, it's lifted from the water source by a petrol pump, conveyed via pipes, and then irrigated. This is the method of choice of irrigation. So at the end of the supply pipe, then it's splashed over. It's like sprinkler irrigation, I was talking about in the morning, but now this time at a more advanced level. We have also flooding of the site. You can see this is totally flooded, and I'm sure you'll appreciate what comes at the end of the day. Nice vegetables. Some of the average results for the water quality, out of 20 parameters that were assessed, including metals, only 4 pH. pH, fluorides, and the good rule were actually
moistened.
I've highlighted this sample here because I'll talk about it later, where you see almost every parameter was out of order.
But
for the rest, even despite the color we saw for the water, the samples were within permissible limits, at least for physicochemical parameters. This is the sample A1 I was talking about. You can see this is where we drew the water from. That's somewhere around here. And you can see these are crops. So this is from the aerial map. So this is where the sample was taken. These are crops grown. Of course, this is a river. So most likely, the water is coming from here. But this a treatment plant for an industrial park where we have export processing zone where they do apparels, textiles and all that. So that water comes out and then goes out, joins the river. So it's likely because this river now for the first time in the last like 5 years it's been drying. It's likely because this factory will keep on running that these people along this tunnel, and you can see it's like a land exit. And you can see also there's another canal coming here. We'll most likely revert to using this water for, at the moment, they are not using it because it's still water flowing through the river. Again, just to show the indicators, parameters that were moistened, pH, and it's around the lower part. On the upper part, northern part, the pH was okay. Same for fluorides. And you know, I was talking about today about fluorides. The levels in fluoride in Nairobi water vary between 1 milligram per liter to 10. And this is levels in the river water, 2.6. The above 1.5, according to WHO. And you can see it's in some section of the city, the other section is still okay. Then, of course, coliforms again, and you can see it's a trend that this section of the city is the one which is actually having a big problem with quality issues. And the problem is the main city is somewhere here, so the other tunnel flows there, the other tunnel flows here and passes through the industrial area. So, these are waters. These are sections of the city, river water, receiving waste from industrial facilities and the city center. The macrobiotic indicators, what is interesting is the number, and you can see it's very low. In some sites, there was actually nothing. And these are the sites passing through the city. Yes. So the sites here, where the river is passing here, in the middle is where we have actually no macroinvertebrates counted. I'm just going to show a few of these sampling points at Crossland just to appreciate. So you see this, the site, the water is fairly good. Again, the system of supply is the same, and this time they are the planning, and these were okra. These are used as vegetable station for the Asian community. And you can see you're basically no macroinvertebrates, even for such what seemingly we look at still to be good quality water. The gray area, this is important for me especially because this like a 5 acre piece of land, flat, the water is passing here, you can see the water, and we have like 1,000 families being farming here. And you can see here, anybody? Sewer line. So what will happen when the water goes down and the guys who are farming around here? For a long time, we used to be told that all the vegetables in Nairobi come from, they are grown with seawater. And that's what will happen when your cathedrals are actually prepared one. Because they block it, they open the manhole, block it, now the water comes up, then they can be able to use it. Actually, they are not doing it now. So those who are coming to Nairobi the next few days, you are safe. Important is, we have one of the largest open air markets in the country. It's this market. We have people traveling as far as 30 kilometers to come to this market because we have very cheap products. And again, you can see the biological quality. We have all the parameters except for that gold. Correlate was not detected and Shigella, but you can see the total bacteria count was quite high. Interesting, this is one of the sites where we had the evidence of a single species. The other said not more than 10 for this, but this particular site was quite high. 2 kilometers downstream of this site is Muyoko, and on the same day when I was taking the previous photo, this year, the same day I took the photo here, and you can see this along the river, and you have things that are forming. Same river, a few, less than 10 kilometers downstream, and that's, we have that. And a few less than 5 meters, we have that site. And again, interesting, this is where we have the largest diversity in macroinvertebrates. So what are we saying here? That of course the water is unsafe, that we have seen, and because of the way we are using the water for irrigation, we are really exposing our customers to contamination. But more important is that this low or no decline in the rivers, even where the quality is seemingly important, and the areas far outside, in the what you call far outside the city, then are the areas that we could be using for production of food, but not the rivers that are passing through the city. We do have regulations about cultivation of agriculture, the quality that should be used, but of course the problem is the enforcement of the regulations. Actually, this is the slide that brought me to this conference, that I was coming, probably that I could get assistance from you people, because you are the environmental indicator experts, on how to get an easy and expensive way in place of bending macroinvertebrates to be able to capture, analyze, and classify, and be able to give what we call a first impression of the kind of water at any given point that we can use for agriculture. Thank you all, and I invite a few questions.